regular season game here at the Coliseum, which means we're talking about Coliseum memories. You've been doing them all season long with different people. What stands out to you? Do you want to start back in the 1980s of something that really stands out here?
Well, when they were going for their third straight Stanley Cup, I'll never forget this, because Pittsburgh actually looked like they were going to knock them out. And the Penguins are leading 3-1. It was a decisive game. And Al Arbor decided that he would get Melanson in to allow a break. This is a very important break. And then Mike McEwen, who was a terrific acquisition, scores. There's still one behind. And then Johnny Tinelli ties the game. And then it goes into overtime. And Johnny Tinelli, once again, this was a phenomenal play. Never forget it. Doesn't look like anything's going to happen. And then Nystrom, Tinelli, that wonderful combination, works again. So it tells me that you never give up in this game of hockey. And that was just a heart-throbbing one. You go back again. There was another terrific game. I talked to Howie Rose about it. We agreed this was one of the greatest, most sensational overtimes. And that was when they were going for the drive for five, the decisive game with the Rangers. Billy Smith out of his mind in the overtime, which enabled the setup. And of course, this was the Kenny Morrow goal. But it started there, really, Tinelli's forechecking. The puck goes back to the point. Kenny Morrow didn't have the greatest shot, but he had a shot that had eyes. It always goes back to 1980 when he came up with a tremendous play. So you got to say, that game, to me, one of the all-time decisive games. To the first Cup year, the Isles got beaten 78 by a Maple Leaf team. You guys were the favorites. The underdogs won that one. Then you play the Rangers in 79. Again, you guys, in regular season, best team in the league. What was going on there? What was missing? And how did that help you guys get better and change things when you won the Cup finally?
Well, I would have to say that, you know, the biggest issue with the 78 series was toughness, for one thing. But, you know, on the 79 series, we put so much pressure on ourselves from the standpoint of winning the President's Cup. And you know, when we got to playoff time, all of a sudden you're saying to yourself, well, what now? You know, like we didn't have any, we couldn't regenerate, you know. So I think that in that respect, we had maybe played it a little bit wrong. But we started off, I would say, fairly poorly in the 1979-80 year. And, you know, we didn't really feel the pressure to accomplish over the season, you know, like we didn't need that, you know. We just wanted to focus on getting ready for the playoffs and being in a position where, when it came to the end of the season, that we were rolling at full power.
To get to the top, got to start the first run. Los Angeles Kings, mm-hmm. You beat them 3-1. What do you remember about the series?
It was a scary, very scary series.
Scary is right.
And we had this big, tall, lanky right winger that came up pretty big for us in that series. And, you know, I mean, he only played a few games with the Islanders, but Alex McKendry came up huge. We had a tough series with LA.
Okay, so you beat the Kings and you play the big, bad Bruins, and we know all about how nasty they were then. So tell me about that, sir. A couple of fights here and there?
Oh, yeah, there was. And it's so funny because Clark and I were watching this show, a newscast on Boston TV, and the, you know, the sportscaster says, ah, yeah, these guys can't match up. The, you know, Bruins are going to run them right out of the building. And with that, Clark and I just about went through the set and just grabbed this guy. But we made a decision that night that we were going to be the guys that had to really lead it off. And I think pretty early on in the game, I fought John Winsick, which I said I was going to do. And then, you know, after I got kicked off, I guess the whole brawl broke out and Clark fought with Terry O'Reilly. And that was really the turning point of the New York Islanders.
And then Buffalo. Yeah. And if I'm not mistaken, Scotty Bowman was coaching them at that time. Mm-hmm. Great genius. And you took care of those guys.
Yeah, well, we were actually able to shut down their big line with Perreault, Rene Robert, and Richard Martin. And that was critical because that was one of the lines that really motivated that team.
Oh, the Flyers had the best record going into the final, and the series opened in Philadelphia. You know, it goes into overtime, and the captain delivers. So right. What do you remember about that?
Well, I remember it vividly. I mean, I've seen the replay on it, and you know, where was Denny when he scored that? He was down a little deep, wasn't he? But again, I think that that's just another example of how attack. You know, like Denny was down low. I think Johnny T actually, you know, assisted on the play. But Denny came in and was able to score that goal, and that set the trend for the rest of the series. After that, there wasn't really a close game until the sixth game.
My guest is Ralph Macchio, film star and Islanders honorary captain and longtime hockey fan. You know, Ralph, this is not the first time we met.
That's true.
And we have proof positive.
Yeah, way so, back. So we go way back, Stan. This was my captain's jersey that the I was invited to be the celebrity captain for the New York Islanders on the 75th, note the 75th anniversary of the NHL, and it was the 20th anniversary of the New York Islanders. And I actually have hockey cards here, Stan. I don't know if I ever gave you a hockey card. But I got my own hockey card.
Oh, nice.
Same year.
Nice.
So I was legit. The team was not as legit at that time.
What do you remember about the first coupling?
I was in, I think it was 338, last row. All I remember is that moment when they were coming down, you know, Connelly the Knights from the past, the whole thing happening.
Connelly, the Nystrom, he scores!
More than the moment, you know, I think my knuckle prints are still in the ceiling. Obviously, the ceiling is so notoriously low that at 5 foot, whatever I was at the time, 5'7", I just, you know, I don't remember anything after that. I just remember that thunder, that rush of we did it. It was, you know, it's a top five memory in my lifetime. So they were like your brothers and your cousins on the ice, where they were passing the cup around and waving to the crowd. It really had a communal family element to it.
It's pretty clear to everybody that in order to win the cup, and guys on the team said they had to stand up to the Bruins. Mm-hmm. Gillies fighting O'Reilly. What about that? What do you remember?
Yeah, that was, I remember one fight. O'Reilly gave a check to a cheap shot to Mike Bossy, and Gillies just, he just turned around and just with a stick, he just called him out, and they just went in. And I just remember that feeling. There was such a camaraderie with that, protecting your finesse players.
Now, you mentioned Bossy. What about the 50 and 50?
That's one of my top memories of being in this building was the 50 goals in 50 games.
Bossy and Butler's third, right to Quattro to Bossy. Shoot, he scores!
I just remember those little roadrunner legs going once he scored that goal, sort of running in place. But I just remember, I was like, what is it, like a minute and a half left in the game, I think. I don't remember the exact time, but it was, everybody just wanted one thing. Win, lose, we don't care. We just wanted that thing.
Right.
And, you know, it's truly when you could write the script and deliver your climax the way you want it. And that's what it was. Another awesome memory for me in this building was, I think it was 84. The Kenny Morrow overtime goal against the Rangers. That was incredible. That was an incredible game. And the reason I remember that game so much is I had seats down. I was probably about six rows up watching the game through the glass. I was always at the, you know, in the back of the barn somewhere looking down or sneaking up when someone got up to go to the, like, please go home early. I'm going to take those seats, you know, as us kids do or us fans do. And I was right in line with the shot that he took. I think it was Sutter took a shot and it rebounded, and it's sort of like a snap slap shot that Morrow took and went in the net, because that overtime was a total nail biter. That was a great
the whole
great
game.
The whole game was great.
You have a son?
Yes.
When did you start him?
He's he jump started. He is he's probably a bigger hockey nut than I've ever been. Another great memory in this building for me, because I thought he'd never see it or experience it. But 2 years ago, he was in the building with me. We were in section 223, and it was the game against Pittsburgh, the first game. We wound up losing the game, but the Islanders took a two-goal lead, and his place was just as I remembered it. And the moment for me, and it was an emotional moment, it was an emotional moment because my son was 17, which is pretty much the exact same age I was when I was here when they were winning the cups. And they scored these back-to-back goals in the first period. The place was insane.
Raptor centering pass, score!
The rafters were shaking, my insides were shaking. It just took me back nostalgically to that time. And there I was with my kid jumping up and down. Sort of, it was a flashback to my childhood, and I got to experience that moment with him. But it was a really a special moment as a fan, as a Long Islander, and as a father. It's fun stuff.